Welcome back to the fourth section in our series on vitamins, and this section we'll be covering vitamin K. What I first like to do is introduce vitamin K as actually two separate vitamins. And this is a little bit of a new concept. In fact, even when I was in school, we only learned about a general vitamin K, not vitamin K1 and K2. Vitamin K1 is mostly known for its synthesis of blood clotting protein. So it helps clot the blood, or it helps in the formation of proteins that are involved in blood clotting. Vitamin K2 is involved in the synthesis of bone proteins, meaning that proteins that are involved in bone formation. K2 is involved in the synthesis of these proteins. Now with K1, the vitamin K that is involved in the synthesis of blood clotting proteins, this is called phylloquinone, and that's the name. You don't actually need to know that in case you're referenced to it, but you can think of it as P as in plant, meaning that this is more of the plant form of vitamin K. Where the minoquinone, down here you can see this is the animal form of vitamin K, and that's K2. Now, vitamin K2 is actually made in the intestines, but it's not actually well absorbed. What you'll find in your book is you're not going to see both vitamin K1 and K2 mentioned, and you're also going to see that vitamin K is produced in the intestines, and therefore we don't need any. But it is produced by bacteria in the intestines, but this is not well absorbed. In addition, although we do have the ability to convert vitamin K1 to K2, we apparently don't do it efficiently enough, so we do need food sources of vitamin K2. Without getting enough vitamin K2, vitamin K, we have a few issues that can develop. Vitamin K1, if we didn't have enough, we'd have uncontrolled bleeding. But I want to point out that this is not that common, and it's because vitamin K1, the body has a very good ability to recycle it, or to reuse this type of vitamin K. And if you think about it, if there aren't a lot of people around you who are falling dead of uncontrollable bleeding, it's not a common problem. And then also vitamin K, and I'll talk about this next, K1 tends to be a more common food source, and most people are getting enough of the vitamin K1. Now vitamin K2 is involved in both if there's a deficiency, then fractures can develop. We think of osteoporosis, but also heart disease. You wouldn't think of it because I just said that it was involved in forming bone proteins. But I'm going to talk about what I mean by this next. And this is an analogy that, it's actually not my analogy, I didn't come up with this, but I'd read this analogy and I think it's a great one to use, because vitamin K2 and vitamin D actually work together. And remember, vitamin D, the role of vitamin D, it has many roles, but the main one is to control how much calcium is absorbed. So vitamin D is the gatekeeper. I think of it as a gatekeeper. Well, okay, we need more calcium. We'll let more calcium into the bloodstream. We have enough calcium. We won't let calcium into the bloodstream. Whereas vitamin K2 is a traffic cop. Now, once calcium comes into the body, it needs to know where to go. Remember when I talked about if there's too much vitamin D, you would get soft tissue calcium deposits, and that they could end up in the arteries. And that's what happens, is if there is no K2, then calcium does not know where to go. It's like coming up to an intersection where the power is out and not knowing when to go or where to go, and you might end up taking the wrong turn, or you might end up, say, in a traffic jam. Well, that's what can happen with calcium. If vitamin K2 is there, the bone proteins that it's involved in forming actually help direct calcium to the right place. So not in the arteries, not in the heart, but into the bone. So we have the gatekeeper, vitamin D, and then the trap-a-cop, which is vitamin K2. So think about K2 as telling calcium where to go once it gets into the body. So if you don't have enough of the K2, you can have enough calcium, and you can even have enough vitamin D, but you might end up with osteoporosis and heart disease because the calcium ends up in the wrong place. Now here's what's really going to surprise you. And you might think I'm crazy once I tell you this, because again, this is not in your book. The food sources are different. Now, the food sources of K1, you're not going to think twice about. I'm going to tell you they're from dark leafy greens and cruciferous vegetables. So you have kale and spinach, romaine lettuce, and then the cruciferous, so we have broccoli and cabbage, and that's K1. And most people will get enough K1 in their diet. Now, the food sources of K2 are actually are a little bit more surprising. I'm telling you that K2 can help prevent heart disease, yet it's coming in sources like butter, egg yolk, and hard cheese. It also comes in some soft cheeses, grass-fed beefs, as well as something called natto, which is this fermented soybean. It's very popular in Japanese culture, but I've heard it's really hard to choke down. I have never tried it. These are sources of things I've been, we talked about increase in saturated fat and trying to avoid food sources with them, but here I am telling you that vitamin K2 can decrease the risk of heart disease. And it's true, but the sources that what's really important to understand is these sources are usually a grass, butter from grass-fed cows is going to have a different nutrient composition. Egg yolk, but it's generally from free-range chicken, and it's been found that Dutch eggs, which we can't get over here, have twice as much vitamin K2 than even our free-range eggs, and it's because of the types of grasses and bugs and insects that the chickens are used to being raised on there compared to here. It's a more natural environment for them. And then the hard cheeses. So I do want you to know these sources. I think it's very important, and I know it's a little bit of conflicting data, but vitamin K is the new and upcoming vitamin, K2, so almost a new discovery, and we're going to be seeing a lot more information about this vitamin in the future, even once you're done with the class. So I do want you to be introduced to vitamin K2, even though it's not in the textbook. And this is the end of the section on vitamin K.